for sure. Okay, okay.
All right, guys, I want to welcome you back to the DRAKEN Station. And you guys haven't already, we have season one, the full season, and it's on YouTube, all 10 episodes. And we are working on season two, and I'm very excited. Here in the DRAKEN Station, I love the new sign by Mars that she made. It's freaking awesome.
Yeah, signs from Mars. Unfortunately, the light, the remote for the light is
in somebody's pocket.
Man. So they took it home with them. So.
Yeah, wait a couple of days to come see it, and it's not even full shown. But before we begin, man, let me take this time to welcome back Vince, the man, the legend, the shaman, the man with the plan.
Just kidding.
Yeah.
I don't want to claim that. Yeah. All right. How you doing, guys? We got Joe over here. How you been, Joe?
I'm fantastic, man.
You're fantastic. How's your week gone?
It's been good, man. Thank you for asking. What have you done all week? Are you
let me introduce. I forgot. We got a couple guys sitting over here. We got this dude over here and this dude over here. We got our guest, Roy Gomez.
That's right. How's right? Going?
We'll get into what he's here to talk about in a little bit. And then we got Freddie over there. He doesn't have a mic. So he's just coming to hang out and hype us out. He's like the hype man. Right, he comes and gets brings the beers if we need extra beers or whatever the case may be. He'll have a mic by next week or another. We'll get another mic where we can throw some other guys on.
Yeah,
but yeah, Joe, how you been doing? How's downtown life?
You know, it's slowly taking shape, but you guys know, man, with the lockdown, it's just not the same. Yeah. But I like it, man. It there's no traffic.
Right.
But everything's closed.
I mean, there's pros and cons.
There's pros and cons,
right?
Everything.
Like you don't like. I mean, you don't like. There's not 1,000 people that are not from downtown.
But listen
downtown.
To this. At the end of the day, I'd rather be in this pandemic in LA than anywhere else. If you ask me personally.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. Right. So I got Roy Gomez here. Uh-huh. Right, brother, and we are here to talk to you about anything you want. But we talked about the format already, right?
Right.
We can either follow that format or we cannot. We can do whatever we want on the show. You can go off the rails on the with your train for a while, and then we can bring it back on the rails. It's up to you. But I like to start just introducing yourself, telling us where you're from, right? So if you know where you grew up, you know, like you mentioned to me earlier that you're Native American.
Wow.
Start with that. You know, start with if you grew up somewhere and left or whatever the case may be. I've worked with Native Americans on reservations and stuff like that, and a lot of them like to take off, right?
Yeah,
some stuff. So you talk to me. So where did you grow up?
So I grew up in East Los Angeles.
Okay, East
grew
LA.
Up in, more specifically, Highland Park.
Okay. Oh, HP, Park. Dude.
Yeah, okay. HOP.
Avenue what?
Avenue, right by Avenue 60.
Oh, okay. Yeah, by the Food for Less.
Yep, exactly. Yeah, dude, where I grew up there. I was, I'm Native American, but for the most part, I grew up more Mexican. Chinese as well. I don't know any of my Chinese culture.
Right.
It's one of those things that kind of got like just lost in the past. And yeah, Native American, I didn't find out until I took a test of the 23andMe, I believe it's called, 23andMe.
Yeah.
And then I was Apache. I'm Apache.
Nice.
So I'm starting to figure out all this more culture. I'm about to be 30. I'm not that old. And I'm finding out more of this stuff and how I grew up. And now I know why I think a certain way. And it's pretty cool.
So what region of the now United States were the Apaches mainly in?
Where?
Right.
So I was thinking where I first thought was Arizona.
Okay.
That's where my grandmother is Chinese and my grandfather is Native American.
Right.
And they met in Arizona.
Okay.
And a lot of Chinese immigrated a lot back then. And my grandparents still to this day will not talk about how they met. So we all come up with our own like ideas and speculations.
Yeah.
Our grandma's a mail order bride. You know, she's the most beautiful woman you've ever met, but she's one of those Asians or Chinese where she looks, curly hair, carries a mask everywhere she goes before the pandemic.
Yeah.
Super cautious. And she speaks fluent Spanish.
Uh-huh.
So everyone, gets thrown for a loop. Like, how did your grandparents meet? How are you Chinese? How
it's,
are they?
It's so, funny, Roy. Funny. We kind of have a similar upbringing. I grew up in Lincoln Heights.
Oh, really? Wow.
So we're neighbors. All my friends were Hispanic. So growing up, you know, I have this like Hispanic edge about me.
Right.
It was weird. People would meet me like my new white friends are like, yeah, but you sound like Mexican. I'm like,
you just have a different accent sometimes. Yeah. I have the same thing. Sometimes it comes out. That's so nice. For me, I grew up in La Puente, El Mani, and then when I would go see my dad, he had a house in East LA, but it's considered East LA, but now it's Commerce.
Okay. Oh,
so off of Downey Road, Downey and Union Pacific, not too far from the King Taco and Olympic. And so, yeah, I was a little white kid, you know, with all the the Mexican kids, right? I mean, they think I'm white, but so, so your grandparents met in Arizona.
Yeah.
But as far as, do you know about the Apache, like as like, far as the history, like if I asked you, like where, if are they, did they really reside or whatever the case may be in Montana area or Kansas or what area of the United States?
I can honestly say, and I would always be honest, I don't know much of that type of my culture.
Okay.
And I'm learning as it through I go. Because I just found out about that being after the 23andMe about my Native American. And everyone always thinks, well, you're Mexican, you know, they automatically assume but never really dig into it.
How long ago did you do the 23andMe?
About 7 months ago.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. So seven months ago. Yeah. So and the Chinese thing, same thing. I guess I can't even, it says it on the 23andMe Chinese as well.
Right.
But I can't get any information through my grandparents, but I'm digging deeper into more and more. I'm doing my own research, not just taking it for what it is and seeing what's going on.
Right.
Because it is something that's crazy. Like I had no idea I was these other, I just thought I was Mexican for the longest time. You know, I just thought like, Mexican, you know, you're brown, my last name's Gomez.
Hey, but Mexican has some Indian in there?
We're now considered because Mexico and it was all the same region, so we're all like we technically are like Native American as
That's just
different Native Americans, right? So like my dad was from Zacatecas and Nochislan and stuff like that. So I did ancestry.com. Okay. So when I did ancestry.com, 33% was Native American but from Mexico, like Nochislan and all that stuff and you know, down there in Mexico. But then there's a bunch of other stuff that's all like Spanish and Norwegian, like crazy Viking stuff. Yeah. It was weird. I was like, okay, well, how'd that happen, you know? But anyways, it happened. So you grew up in Highland Park.
Yep.
Right? And you eventually went into the military.
Yes.
Right? What was it like growing up for you in Highland Park?
Well, I got lucky in a sense because my family knew all like the gang members. And they were all, you know, a lot of gang members. I don't know if anyone's grown up with them. They are a lot more about family.
Right.
So the kids never really, you know, hopefully never get exposed to that type of their lifestyle and nothing but to take care of them.
Right.
So I got lucky because I grew up playing sports around a lot of those gangsters' families' kids.
Right.
So I got close with them. I'd go to their houses. I'd hang out with all of them. And I knew really older gangsters that I had no idea because they were just so kind to me. But you asked me how they look like. They look like the bald mustache, Dickies, long socks, and they all look like that.
Old school OG cholos.
Mm-hmm. And then one day I really started to take advantage or take more interest when I saw this documentary series. I forgot on what show. It might have been the History Channel, but it's called Gangland.
Yeah.
And it was called The Avenues or Highway to Hell.
Yeah.
And The Avenues was all on it, and it showed my hometown, like Highland Park. Right. And I'm like, I grew up there my whole life. I never once saw anything. And I'm like, they talked about a bridge where murders were committed. I'm like, I've been there a million times. And so it's a crazy, you know, experience to think about what you're, you know, accustomed to and what you see at a certain age.
Right.
And then the more I got into it, the more I was like, whoa, like, I guess I just got lucky. I'm one of those
guys
avenues, that got
the
out.
Avenues don't mess around, right?
Yeah, the one I was one of those lucky that just got out. And I tell people, like, I would have, if I joined the army for a reason to get
But
out.
You know what? During that time of that decade, nowhere was safe. Avenues was bad. Echo Park was bad.
It was all
East
bad.
LA
it was
all
Hazard.
Bad.
Hazard
Hazard,
Park?
Venice
yeah.
Beach.
It was all bad. Yeah.
It was all bad. So a lot of people that they come here now, they don't know.
Right. Reno.
Like, if we grew up in a neighborhood, we stay in that neighborhood. Mm-hmm. That's why you
Boyle
felt
Heights.
Safe. Yeah, that's why you felt safe.
Yeah, yeah.
Because
you grew up and
I couldn't even go to Boyle Heights and I wouldn't dare.
No, yeah, of course.
It's like I stayed in Lincoln Heights and that was it. That and four blocks, I'm there.
And Highland Park is gentrified now.
Yes, you see the avenues or like Figueroa, like you see all that stuff. It's just all coffee shops and everything, like, you know, and you're like, whoa, like especially after getting out of the army.
I trip
on
Echo Park, man.
And anytime anything happens gang related in the community, all the homeowners and everybody goes to the community leaders and goes, hey, what's going on? And so that's why it gets shut down fairly quickly in Highland Park. when I grew up, I don't know if it was the King Cobras or whatever in East LA, but the same thing with me is my dad had a couple of duplexes and he rented a couple of the houses. So they were always nice to me because they actually lived in the houses that my dad was renting out to them. So same thing with you. Like, they didn't fuck with me, even though, like, my mom would send me to East LA with a little Hawaiian t-shirt, bro, and I had blonde hair, blue eyes, dude, right? And then my dad would buy me, like, a nice-ass $200 BMX bike. So then they would pick on me, but they would have never give me a hard, like, right. a hard time. Like, I never got beat up.
Life-threatening.
And if anybody ever did mess with me, they, like, you know, one of the OGs was in the one that lived in one of the houses that my dad rented out. His whole family did, so I didn't have any problems. So what made you decide to go into the military?
Man, there's a couple reasons. First of all, I didn't want to join a gang, even though I was so, like, kind of drawn to it.
Right.
Like, this type of brotherhood, or, like, kind of, like, having... We all want friends that will do anything for you, right? We all want those types of traits in a person. But with the gang, it kind of was more... You know, like,
well, you gotta do dirt. Yeah, you gotta do dirt. It comes along with that.
And I had some, fortunately, I had other sides of the family that were a lot of military and grew up in the same area and are doing way better for themselves. So I kind of clung to that one. I was like, you know what? Let me try this.
Now, was this directly out of high school, or was this something that you were thinking about in high school? Did you graduate high school?
I graduated high school. I graduated from Rosemead High School in 2008. I didn't join right out of high school, even though I thought about it. I was like, let's try the college thing. Let's try what my mother wants, because I love my mother, single mother, growing. She's like, I want you to go to college. I want you to get good grades to go to college. So I was like, you know, let me try this. Right. So I did 2 years of, I went to PCC at first for a year and trying to major in psychology. Then after, I figured that wasn't about me.
Yeah.
And then I tried it. I did another year at Rio Hondo for fire science, for like firefighting.
Right.
Then I started talking to more firefighters. Mm-hmm. They're like, there's like a 7-year waiting list for someone in Los Angeles. I'm like, whoa.
Yeah, back then it was
7 years?
Yeah, it was a long time. And I knew firefighters, so I was like, I can't wait this long. I was like, I'd rather join the military, and it actually seems like something I'd want to do. I'm open to try, you know, that type of stuff. And I see that my family was doing really well for themselves, being at a younger age.
Right. So about 2 years after high school, you did a couple college. You're at PCC, you're at Rio Hondo.
Right.
And then you said, you know what, let me try the military.
Mm-hmm. Yep, so I joined at 20 years old.
And what made you join the infantry?
So I always tell these funny stories. I said, I was just some immature kid saying, I want to go to war.
Okay.
I told my recruiter, just send me to war. I don't want any desk job.
Oh, they love that.
Yeah. I don't want any desk job. Send me as a 11 Bravo.
They love you, dude.
Yeah. So they're like, oh, this is the perfect one. And then, you know, they eventually, they did give me a little hard time. You know, they're like, oh, there's no spots for infantry. And luckily I had military family members. Like, there's always spot for infantry.
There's always spot. What happened? I mean, infantry, your ASVAB test doesn't really even matter at that point, right? They're like, we got a slot. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you went to a recruit? Did you go to a particular recruiter or?
So at first I went to the Marine Corps for infantry.
Okay.
But I had too many tattoos at the time.
Okay.
And not even that many, but like I still had on my lower arms,
on your forearms
and stuff like that.
The Marines at the time wouldn't allow anything on the forearms. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I was like, oh, you know what, shucks. And then I was like, you know what? They're like, everyone takes the army. Or anyone takes it in the army. I was like, okay. Then I started to get into it. I'm like, it is a little harder, but they do take. None of my tattoos are sexist.
You get a waiver.
There's no
KKK or swastikas or brown pride or anything on your arms. So then you're good to go. So you join. So you join the army.
Yeah.
Did you go right to boot camp, or did you do delayed entry program, or did you go straight to boot camp?
So I waited 6 months.
Okay.
Yeah, 6 months. And went to basic training and stuff like that. Yeah, I went to
Georgia.
OSU. Yeah, Georgia, Fort Benning.
Okay.
12 weeks in OSU at UT. Yeah.
And then, so for when I was in, it was AI. It was boot camp, basic training, and then it was AIT.
Mm-hmm.
And for you guys now, it's OSU.
Yeah.
OSU. Yeah. So you did everything in Georgia at Fort Benning.
Right.
11 Bravo was your MOS.
Yes.
They don't even at this point. They don't even have 11 hotels. They just 11 Bravo.
And Charlie.
And 11 Charlie. Yes. 11 Mics are gone.
Yeah,
right. So you join, you do your boot camp, and then you get stationed.
Fort Carson, Colorado.
Fourth ID. Not too far from Denver.
Nope, not at all. So maybe like an hour.
So everybody gets an idea of where it's at.
Right. Colorado Springs as well.
The atomic clock is right in that area too, right?
NORAD's right.
NORAD. The mountain is right there. Mm-hmm. Right. Cool. And then how did you like did you get there in the winter, or did you get there in the summer? When did you get there?
I got there in the January, so it was still pretty cold. You know, there was one thing that people would tell me before going to Colorado Springs, you get all the seasons in one day.
Right.
And I'm like, you're just full of it. Like, there's no way. Like, there's no way it's going to be a blizzard and then...
And then sunny.
And that's exactly what it was.
And now, have you ever... Because I was from California. I'm from California. Obviously, we're from California. Yeah, yeah. And they put me on the other side of the country where it's like negative 13 on a normal day. So did you ever experience the cold weather like that until you got there? That you got to experience it.
Right, like a full effect of like, I didn't know what cold was type thing. Yeah, like hot, okay, I can understand. But, and also I didn't know that I couldn't drink as much because I thought I was a cool drinker before.
Oh, because of the altitude.
That's the first thing they tell you. But the cold was the worst thing. And I loved the cold, but you know, California, where we were at, I was out in Los Angeles, doesn't get too crazy.
Right.
And I'm like having to like do this and, yeah, it was, and the wind chill as well, which definitely.
Well, yeah, the wind chill when you're running in your PTs.
Yeah.
And everything's like.
As long as you got your boogers, PT belt
your
on.
Boogers are freezing. Yeah, PT belt for everything.
Be careful.
Your boogers are freezing up. Your eyes are watering, but that's freezing up and everything when you run. So, how did you like Fort Carson?
Beautiful place. It was all the barracks. We got lucky because we walk out and there's literally the mountains. You know, you walk out, you go to vacation spots. And you're blessed to like have a spot where you walk out and it's just nature in a sense.
Right.
And we walked out of there up in the mountains and it was just all, you know, especially in, snow makes everything beautiful.
Right.
It covers everything in a sense.
Yeah.
And it was awesome, man. I really enjoyed it. A lot of people around there were really nice, aside from the assholes you meet occasionally, like everywhere else. But being around from military town had its pros and cons. You know, everyone's like, oh, military people are assholes or... We love military.
Well, yeah. Well, we cause a lot of trouble.
Yeah. For sure.
But some people are accepting of that because they know the lifestyle with the military. So they're like, okay, yeah, you guys cause a lot of trouble. Yeah,
blowing out steam.
That's just what young dudes full of testosterone do, right?
That's the truth.
So you. How long were you at Fort Carson before you decided to get deployed? Or not you decided, but your unit.
I was at Fort Carson for only like 2 months.
Okay.
Yeah. I got out of basic training and then I think 2 months later.
So you didn't even get acclimated to your unit.
Right.
Because for what I tell people that is sometimes the difference in between the Army and the Marines, because the Marines, they're like, well, the Marines boot camp is longer.
Right.
I'm like, well, because our units are so different in the Army, we're all almost specialized for different things. When I say that, I'm talking about the infantry units that are like, you know, the 18th Airborne Corps. We're all pretty much specialized in different things.
Right.
You learn more about what you're supposed to do or what your job is when you get to your unit. So you in 2 months you don't get to learn much, like, you know,
SOPs.
Your leaders are like whatever. Every unit's medal is different, mission essential task list is different, SOPs are different, right? So you didn't get to learn much before you got gone. And plus, you don't even know the dudes you're working with yet, right? They don't trust you, maybe, and you don't. You're just like you're a brand new E1, E2, right? You're boot cherry. So 2 months roll up and you guys get the word, you guys get orders to roll to Afghanistan or Iraq?
Afghanistan.
Okay, so you went to Afghanistan. How was that?
Well, you brought up a great point, actually. Like you said, a company that I haven't been training with or something. I actually joined, I was late to the, so I joined, graduated basic training and then my unit was already ready deploying before like I graduated.
Okay.
So they're all going through their own stuff. Right. So I got assigned to a company called Rear Detachment.
Rear D, Alpha
Company.
Right.
So I trained with them until those 2 months until I was ready to go. So I thought I was going to go back to Alpha Company.
Right.
And then mid travel, they're like, you're going to Bravo Company. That was even worse. I didn't know anybody,
you know?
I mean, especially being a private.
Yeah.
Now you have to start all over.
Right.
All over. But Afghanistan was, you know what, I hate to like say it was great because it made me appreciate so much more, like this, you know, the typical response you get from people.
Right. Well, a lot of people haven't been to a third world country.
Right.
So when you're in a third world country, you appreciate things a lot more, right?
Yeah. And then everyone asks me like, well, what was it like? I'm like, exactly what you're thinking like it is.
Yeah.
And that's when people are like, oh shit, you're right. Like it's exactly what you think.
Everybody's experience is different, right?
Exactly what you think it is. And then it's, you know, and a lot of people go straight to the hellhole. I'm like, it is bad. Of course it is. I probably formed the best bonds I've ever had with people over there and have memories that I'll remember for till I die.
Yeah.
But it is.
Well, you have to accustom yourself to a different way of living.
Right.
Altogether. Like, you got to take a shit, you're going to the outhouse and with your rifle and you take a shit and then, and it's like, it could be hot or whatever the weather is, it could be freezing or whatever. And every time you have to take a shit, if it's in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, you got to take a shit. You got to go. You don't have no choice. If you got to piss, either piss in a piss bottle and fucking drain it out later or whatever. But like, you're completely, your way of life is completely different. You're not taking showers every day. You know, it's just completely different. And if you can't acclimate to that, it gets, some people can't handle it.
Right? Oh, yeah. So, it's unfortunate to see a grown man break in front of you.
Right. Just like the life.
Yeah, it's really a weird thing. And, you know, we all go
sometimes
through,
leaders that you look up to. Right.
You're like, I'm supposed to be taking orders from him or listening to him.
And right. If he's an E5 or your team leader or some shit. Yeah.
And you know, and it's really crazy to think that way. It's funny that you brought up about like you're taking a shit somewhere.
Right.
You know, there's been multiple occasions where you're going out to the outhouse and you get into contact.
Right.
And everyone's like, why couldn't I just take a shit in peace?
Never.
No.
Yeah.
Or people don't take a shit for a week or two because the MREs back
you up.
Get all
backed up.
Yeah.
I never understood that. I was always good to go, dude.
Oh, no.
I could always drop a deuce. No problems. Well, I was super regular
on that one.
You would get backed up, yeah.
Oh yeah, for sure. It was like, and we talked like, dude, this is bad. They're like, well, no shit. Like we can't have your shit every fucking 3 hours.
Right, right, you know? Right. So how long were you? Were in 6 months in Afghanistan?
It was around 6 or 7. Okay. Yeah, I got there late, so it was a 9 month deployment. Got there around at the very end of seven.
Gotcha, gotcha. So. You do Afghanistan. Is there anything you want to talk? Is there anything that you want to mention that most people get wrong about Afghanistan or just being deployed in general?
So not everyone's a bad person over there. You know, there are bad people. It's the same thing like America. You know, there are the radicals. But I think it's one thing that a lot of people take for granted here, and I hate to see it, and I don't want to be that pretentious prick that just says you don't know how good you have it.
Right.
But there are very many good things to what's going on.
Right.
And you know, I've seen bad, and it doesn't make me any better than you or think I know better or know more than you.
Right.
But I definitely want to let you know that there is this other side where people really want to see you hurt.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And really like, and it's in a graphic way, not just some I punch you and you get the point. It's to the point.
And it's hateful, and they don't even know why. It's just like, it's just in them.
Yeah, and it's shitty, and people.
Well, a lot of times too, we are occupying their country.
That is true.
Imagine we would feel.
It is true.
Somebody just like, hey, we're gonna come into your country. We're gonna tell you what the fuck to do.
Yeah, for sure. I understand that. Yeah. I understand that, and I get that point. I really do. But the other point is, they are bad people like that. Mm-hmm. That's it. That's all my really is. And I say the same thing. Like, I wouldn't want anyone coming into my home.
Right.
When I'm trying to, you know, solve my own problems.
Right.
Like, let me and my family maybe do that.
Yeah. And the evil people out there, they already have their thing going.
Mm-hmm.
And you're basically fucking it up for them. Right. So you have either the Taliban or Al Qaeda or whatever. Mm-hmm. They're running the show.
Right.
And they like it. Right. Mm-hmm. And U.S. is going in there and you're fucking it up for them. Right, they don't get to do everything that they did.
Right,
it's like the Russians controlling the prostitution and drug Russian Armenians over here, and then a new occupying force comes in and fucks it up. They're automatically gonna go to war with you.
You wanna know what's funny? I sometimes I think, you know, it's 2020. Why are we still all fighting, right? But then, as you get older, you realize there's some shit we done to them a long time ago that they have never forgotten. Or they can't let go, and this is why we're always gonna be in war. They don't want to be controlled just as much as we don't want to be in control.
Right.
And it's just this game, and I don't think it'll ever end.
No, it will never. It'll never end. People think so, but look how people act when COVID happens, right? People are like, no, we're all civilized.
What's wrong with our country?
Wow. Don't give them water for 3 days. See how civilized they are, right?
It's terrible, man.
Yeah, or people are fighting because they have to wear a mask. People are getting shot over having to wear a mask. And those are all the people that were like, oh, why can't we just all be peaceful in the world? We all should be civilized people.
Yeah,
and you guys are arguing and over masks, and people are getting shot over masks. One person saying Black Lives Matters, another person says All Lives Matter, that person shoots this person.
Yeah.
I took your motto. I just tell them, well, what are you going to do about it?
Right. What are you going to do about it?
What are you going to do about it? Like,
those people don't really, those people that do that. But so you go to Afghanistan, you come home.
Yeah.
Right. You're on like into year two of your enlistment, right? Somewhere around there.
Yeah.
Almost
yeah,
year three.
And, yeah. Yeah. Two
does
and
the
half,
years go
two
by
and
fast
half.
For you guys? Or does it feel like
it depends?
Damn,
it,
so long
it depends
year.
At the it depends with the unit you're with, dude. Because yeah. if your morale sucks, and your leadership sucks, then you just don't want to be with it. Be there. You're miserable. Then yeah, it's gonna drag out.
It's same thing as a good boss. I tell people like yeah. It's like having a good boss with normal day work, civilian life. If you want to have a you have a true. Good boss that you look up to, you know yeah. You want to be there.
Yeah. Right.
It's same thing. You know, it is military. You have to understand that it's not some summer camp job.
No.
Where you get to wear a uniform and look cool and carry a gun and shoot it.
Yeah.
A lot of
and
people tend to forget
like,
that.
Oh, right, man.
Yeah. Nah. Look at you. No, it's like if it's not a game, if you want to take, you have to take it seriously.
I want to ask a question because I've been wanting to ask this.
Of course.
So you guys have gear, right? I'm talking about guns. Right. Now, how often do you guys get to practice? Because you just don't walk months just not shooting something, right?
Shooting.
Do you have training like, okay, let me throw a grenade just to see.
Well, you train, if you're in garrison, right, you're at home in the States, and you can jump in if you want to.
Of course.
But you're constantly training, so you're doing live fires, you're doing.
But constantly.
Well, but here's the difference. There's a difference between qualifying with your weapon, right? So when you go to the range and you're specifically going to qualify, which I think is every 6 months, so it's twice a year you actually have to qualify. Mm-hmm. But you're doing different training exercises. Like for us, it was Commando Peak, Mountain Peak, because it was all related to Fort Drum and 10th Mountain. So they just name them different things. So you're doing things, you're doing live fires, you're doing trench live fires, you're doing CQC, close quarter, CQB, close quarter. You have a CQB or a mount with military operations. Yeah. You have a city, and you're constantly training with your firearm, but you're not necessarily qualifying to make sure that you can still shoot, you're gonna hit your target.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? But so you're training a lot. When you're in garrison, you're training a lot. At least every twice a quarter out in the field, at least. Yeah, I mean.
No, that was exactly right. Yeah, of course, there's certain times, you know, I don't mean to get political with it, but there were times where during the Obama administration, a lot of funding was taken away from us. So we used to go like once every month or once, right. You know, we used to go often.
Out in the field.
Yeah, you know, and then it just got took to like, we became glorified janitors. And you see a lot of memes of like infantrymen, like, getting good at cleaning, you know, making
right.
jokes.
Popping,
jokes at ourselves, but
doing a lot of sergeant's time inside.
But we do glass houses outside if we couldn't train. We do just tape or cones or put it tape on the ground or whatever we can find
right.
to do, you know, make it work.
Your sergeants will make you make sure you train.
Yeah.
Right. Even if it's grabbing your compass and a map, because you don't need much. You can just grab the, because I was in the scout sniper platoon for our battalion. So, and we were always training, even when the company or the unit wasn't training, we were grabbing our compass, our maps, our gear, and then going out to whatever TA training area 6 or whatever training area, and doing navigation on our own. You know, no one was bothering us. So your leadership, if your leadership squared away, they will make sure you're training constantly.
Yes, for sure. That's 100% true, man. You know, you learn. It sucks that, you know, you kind of like have to appreciate the bad people and the bad leaderships in your life, because you're like, I never want to be with that person. When I become that leadership, that's you know, that specialist team leader, that sergeant team leader or corporal, you're like, I never do this. And you start to grow, and that's how those, you know, greater leaderships happen.
Yeah, you see who you want to be like, and you see who you don't want to be like.
Well, that's a skill that not many have. Like, you're not going to like everybody you work with.
Right.
But everybody has something you can take away from, right? Mm-hmm. And just like you said, if you have a good boss, sergeant, that you love waking up every day and knows that he has your back and he makes it fun, it's gonna be pleasant.
Right.
But then there's always that one drill sergeant, no matter what job, that you just hate that
motherfucker. You're getting smoked all the time.
Yeah, you just hate that motherfucker.
They're smoking
like,
you
like
for
one
everything.
Second late, yeah, you're just like, fuck you. If someone calls in sick and you call me, I'm not gonna even pick up
my
the
very,
phone.
My very first team leader, we were getting smoked like every day for no, I mean, yeah, we did have a couple in our team. We did have a couple guys that were like shitbags.
Right, of course.
But we were getting smoked constantly, dude.
It was there.
And like, so I went to the scout platoon, and then I was there for like a year or two, and then we were in formation one time, and then I saw he was like an Alpha Company or Bravo Company at the time, and he comes up and he's like, Specialist Lopez, and I was like, what's up, son? And he was like, hey, man, whenever you want to come back to the line, you want to come back to my team. And in my head, I was like, I'm all set. I'm good. You know what I mean? But like, cause he was a bad leader, but he was just doing what he was taught, right? So you just pick up the habits, right, from what you're taught, and you think because you're so young and you're easily influenced, right? And so you think, and because you're cherry in the army, you're brand new, you think that that's what, and you're like, you see the movies, right, where guys are hard asses, and most of the older movies, guys are all the guys are like, oh, rah, rah, ooh, rah, rah, hard, hard. So you see this person, you're like, damn, that dude's making us do push-ups all the time, and he's always being a dick, and he's fucking hard as fuck. Okay, that's what the soldier's supposed to be like, right? And then they get influenced like that, you know? Unless you get influenced by another leader, then you think that that's how
you're
supposed to
be. Can you imagine if we saw, like, you guys just being cool and boys? People be like, what a bunch of freaking...
It happens.
That's protecting our country, you know? Well, yeah. Right? Well, it's the mentality we get.
Well, it's like it's just discipline, dude. Like, okay. So for example, like during the riots, right? I saw the sheriffs and stuff like that, and we were doing security, but we were joking around with our guys, and the sheriffs were joking around. It's like you can laugh and have a good time with your buddies, dude. Mm-hmm. You don't have to be locked up.
But it's constantly. The perception that we put.
That's the perception that people put.
Yeah.
Like, oh yeah, like dude, let the guys, or like, you know, or when you're on downtime, or if you're doing QRF and you're downtime and you guys are fucking around, like playing fuck games, right? Or like, you know, like or doing something stupid, like throwing the knife, the bayonet, like in between. Like, these are the guys that are protecting us, they're gonna stab each other's foots, or you're doing this one or whatever. It's like, dude, go to fucking Afghanistan, get deployed somewhere, go to a third world country. You don't have Netflix, you know, sometimes you do, depending on where you're at, but you don't have anything to do all day. You see these guys, like, you wake up in the morning, you see the same fucking dude's face, right? And you go to bed, you see the same fucking dude's face, right? And you guys hear each other's drama, what's going on at home, this and that. You got to entertain yourself, dude, and you're with these guys like constantly. So it's like, if we fucking want to fuck around, let us fuck around. What are you doing about it?
It doesn't take anything away from what we can do on the battlefield.
Right, exactly.
Like, if I want to be a little stupid with you, like, I can make jokes and say something stupid, but it doesn't take away what I've already been trained to do.
Right. Like the NFL, dude. You're telling me athletes don't go out and have a good time?
Oh, 100%.
Right, but when they get on the field or they get on the court, their game time's on, right? So it's the same thing.
Here's the funny thing, man. They act like we're not human and we don't want to have a good time. And I'll give you a prime example. When I was working for a corporation, I was young, right? I was like 23. Everyone was like 35 and up, family.
Right.
And my Facebook was new at that time. I would be clubbing, but they hated that.
Of course, bro.
They used that as, he's immature. Right. He's not ready. Oh. But when you look at my numbers, was always solid because I could separate when it's go time.
Right.
And when it's
like, as long as it doesn't affect your work, dude.
Yeah, work and play.
No, we could talk about that all the time. In Europe, dude, lunch break, we can go get a beer, no big deal. Here's
I'm
gonna tell on you, and you know what I'm talking about, dude. Everybody knows what I'm talking about.
It's just the haters.
Yeah, haters, dude. Yeah. They act like they don't drink and they don't party, and the corporations, it's like high school all over, kissing ass.
Sometimes they got weirder stuff or like worse stuff than what you do, just because you go out and they're all fucking each other, they're doing coke, they're doing stuff. You got what I'm saying? They're doing coke on the job.
Yeah.
They're doing stuff that's crazier than.
And you don't know until you become management. You're like, so this is what you guys be fucking.
Yeah,
doing.
Exactly.
You guys are no better.
Yeah, exactly. Sometimes they're worse.
Yeah.
So you come back from Afghanistan. Right. You got 2 years left, right? You're riding it out.
Yeah.
And then at what point you were supposed to get deployed again?
Yes. So we were, you know, I think it's every other year on the line. Infantry, you deploy.
Depending on the tempo. Like during wartime. And
well, that's what we were doing. Yeah. That's how it was set up. Right. And we were going along about it, doing our training, the same thing. And we get, we like to party.
Right.
You know, we were single, or most of us were single, had money too.
Well, in the barracks. In the barracks.
But we also had the cool, like, dudes that got the off barracks thing.
So right. Off post house.
We'd always fucking, we'd always go there.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, don't drink and play with firearms. that's, if there's one thing you could take away from this whole podcast, no matter if you're comfortable, if you're like, oh, it's cool, I've had a certain amount of beers, whatever, I can handle firearms.
Yeah, I've been handling firearms since I was 16.
Doesn't matter. We were, I don't want to say like the best trained, but we were trained pretty heavily.
Right.
And someone still did something, shot me, because, it plays into, not about how you're trained, but when you start to involve alcohol and firearms, it's It's more about how you're feeling and what's going on, not how much you've been trained to do. Like, yeah, you can still rack it and know what you're doing and load it properly, but your emotions get in the way, and that all goes out the window, you know? Yeah. And it's about you now. It's about what's going on in your head. And I can't be in your head, so something might happen. And that eventually,
especially when you come back from deployment.
Yeah. Coming back from deployment with problems on your, you know, about your family, your wife, your kid.
Right.
That's really, you know, you see people get torn up overseas about that.
Right.
Let alone, you know, when you come home, when the real fight happens.
And you're there.
Yeah.
Right. Now you have to experience. It's like it's like if you're in another country, like on vacation, and someone passes away that's close to you.
Right.
It doesn't register till you get there, mm-hmm. and you have to go to the funeral and stuff, right? Same thing. So you took a round.
Yep.
So it put you in. Do you have to have surgery?
Yes, I had to have surgery.
So you went to the TMC.
I had to have surgery. I thought I was gonna die initially. Sorry, I'm just trying to like.
Yeah, no worries. Go ahead.
I had to have surgery initially. They thought I was gonna die because you know usually people that do kill shots, it's to the groin, to...
Right. Wait. So you're messing around and someone shot you. Right?
Yeah, we were back at... So this, let me just break it down real fast. It'll take like 2 minutes. We were back in the States at my buddy's house, my best friend's house, after deployment and everything like that, having a barbecue, thinking it's gonna be a good old time. And he had problems from home, actually where he lives, not where he's stationed. And, you know, he couldn't, you know, keep up with it. And unfortunately, he pulled out a gun because Colorado is an open carry state.
Right.
So as long as you're not a felon or 21 and older, you can carry a handgun and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And he just, a night of partying, led him to a trained dude that I've seen shoot all the above. He got a little overboard and decided
Now, were you guys fucking around and he was going like this?
No, not at all.
Or he just was, that's it.
Not at all. That was it. I walked in because I woke up and he was my best friend, so everyone's like, handle him.
Right.
Or like, take care of him.
Gotcha. You know? Yeah, talk to him.
Right. Yeah.
He'll so listen to you.
Yeah, I walk in. Exactly. I walked in and he pulls out, you know, the gun out of his drawer and racks it, you know, so I know it's for real. I've seen
live
it before.
Round in the chamber,
I've seen it before. I know where he hides it. I know where he keeps it.
Right.
And he starts waving it. Like, you better leave before
at you.
Yes, at me. Yes. Right. And he's doing this, but like, he's drunk, so he's doing this type, like,
right.
There's other people in the house who's like, you better leave before I shoot you and everyone else.
Right.
So at first I'm like, okay, I can either do this and, you know, handle it, or I'm going to tell everyone else, like, this is what's going to go on
in
case this happens. So I run out real fast. I let everyone know. And there's a split decision. Either I can let him do that to himself, or I can help everyone else. And it's not like choosing sides.
Right.
But like, I need to like, dude, I don't want this to happen.
You're by yourself.
And everyone else comes in and sees that when maybe we can all... help.
Right.
So that's what happened. He was wrestling with the gun. I won't say his name because I own a.
We are friends.
We don't need names, yeah.
Yeah, we are friends. And I ended up being shot in the groin.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you had surgery, you made it out, right?
Yeah, barely. Yeah.
And that's the first time you ever took any gunshot to the
body. Oh, right. Yeah. The first time.
Man, I would have been fucking scared.
I got shot in the groin, like literally an inch away from my private, you know, my penis.
So you're good on that.
Everything's okay. So that's for the first thing.
Are you single or are you?
No, I am in a.
Okay, cool.
Committed.
So I was gonna say for ladies, if you guys are wondering, but yeah, he's good to go. All right, so that keeps you from deploying.
Yes.
So you basically have to ride out the rest back at home, right? The rest of your enlistment.
So I was actually I recovered from my gunshot. So I started training because I wanted to join the Ranger Battalion.
Okay.
So I knew a lot of Rangers at the time.
Yeah.
So I trained, day trained, and I ended up snapping my foot.
Oh wow.
So I have like metal plates and screws in my foot.
That's crazy.
And then it was time for reenlistment. I'm like, you know, I'm doing this. I took the ASVAB again because I got like a 98 on my GT the first time.
And you need 110.
And 110, yes. Yeah. So I took the ASVAB again.
Right.
And I qualified and everyone was helping me, every Ranger that I knew, everything.
Right.
And then I snapped my foot and I'm like,
yeah,
I can't. Like, even right now, being as stubborn as I am, I physically cannot go.
Yeah, you probably would have had a real hard time going through RASP.
Right? Yeah, I still have a hard time, like, you know, with, you know, all my injuries. And they were like, you reenlist and you can be someone else behind a desk. I'm like, I'm sorry. Like, I'd rather not do that.
Get out. You're like all or nothing, right?
I mean, as much as I don't want to like do all that, like, or be in harm's way, I do. Like, And the older you get, like, the more I'm afraid, but the more I know.
Right. Knowledge. And that's in everything. You have a knowledge of it, so you have less fear of it.
Right.
You understand things more, and you're like, it is what it is.
Yeah.
I do the best I can. That person does, and this is like confiding too.
Right.
I do the best I can. That person does the best I can. It is what it is. Right. So you get out, and so did you come back to Cali? Did you stay over in Colorado for a little while? What did you? What'd you end up doing?
So I stayed in Colorado for a while. I think like a year or two, a year and a half. Like it was a year and a half to 2 years.
Was that for any particular reason?
Just because I loved it out there. It was beautiful.
So you did get an apartment out there or something?
We did, yeah. I got an apartment and a house with my friends out there.
Gotcha.
Luckily, I had people that wanted to stay out there as well.
What were you doing for work when you were... when you were out there?
So I had a job at GameStop for a little while.
Okay.
Yeah, nothing crazy, nothing like that. I just had
something to pay the bills.
Yeah, just a little. And honestly, like, I got lucky. I told them I didn't know what I wanted to do. So they're like, you know what, man? Like, as long as you're trying something,
right?
Let's see. Because I was going through, like, I had depression
right
after I got shot, because it stuck with me for a while.
Right.
You know, I got shot 7 years ago.
Yeah.
And I didn't, when I was in the Army, they made me go through therapy because they saw, like, Roy, you're not what you used to be, or Gomez.
Right.
And so I had to go through therapy. So I took it kind of out, especially not knowing what you're going to do after you get out, about knowing what you could have done before you were in and everything. So I had a really, like, hard time. And luckily I had the good fucking brothers, you know, my Army brothers that were there for me and
holding you down.
Yeah, no, they really did. I could have gone a lot, you know, darker path. So it really shows me. And that's why I tell people, like, dude, it's all about those good friends, that brotherhood and
the core.
Yeah. And a lot of, you know, I hope you understand it. I hope anyone understands it. That one person just changes your life. And I not even about like a relationship wise, that homie, that whatever, a confidant, and that's what I had, luckily. And I realized, like, okay, you know, I like Colorado, but let me get back to LA. Let me get back to my family, because I'm very family oriented.
You had FOMO.
Yeah.
Fear of missing out.
Yep.
Yeah, which a lot of us do. Yeah.
So I came back, and I don't regret it. You know, I do miss the scenery. It's obviously different from seeing downtown LA, you know, in Colorado Springs, but everything's everything I wanted.
So you come back home.
Yep.
You back with your family, your friends. Some friends have moved on. They're doing different things. And then you start getting into other stuff, right? You start getting into combatives and defensive systems, right?
Right.
So while you were, did you get a job when you got back out here? And then you started exploring other things, or how did that work out?
So yeah, I at first was, I'm gonna be honest with myself, I was being like, oh, I just got home, let's just hang out,
relax a little bit.
Yeah, that's how I was, and I will tell anybody that. And then I've done martial arts growing up sporadically throughout my life, and it's something that I've gone to. I always watch on YouTube or have a beer and watch these Kung Fu, Jackie Chan, Bruce Lee, all the above. So I got back home and I'm like, and I wanted to find a sense of brotherhood. I wanted to find, like, civilians don't understand me, in a sense. Like, I can make these jokes and no one gets it.
Yeah.
And I don't know what else to do. So I started, you know, I seen martial arts sort of following a lot more. And I saw they all joke the same way, and they're badasses too, you know. They know what they're doing. They're trained, at least for the most part. You know, I can't speak for everybody.
Right.
And I cling to it. And I just been doing it ever since I got out.
What did you start off with?
So I started off with Master of Defense System, MDS. It's a self-defense street system that's not based off of MMA. Or it's based off of MMA, but it's not MMA. Like, I'm not going to fight you in the ring.
Right.
It's someone's trying to take my car while I'm walking to my, you know, walking to my car. If someone grabs me from behind, what do I do? Not just, I'm fighting you, you're fighting me.
Right, not so, a square up scenario.
Yeah, like, we both know we're going to punch.
Right. So it's very... self-defense based, but in scenarios that are likely to happen to you on the street.
Right, exactly. Yeah, that's all it is. And there's nothing more. I do MMA, I do boxing, I do all the above. I mean, I try to. I try to practice it, but mostly my style is based off of the everyday person that doesn't have time to train, you know, 3 hours a day in the gym.
Right.
The mother that just wants to be like, hey, I have two kids. I just want to, like, take an hour out of the, you know, a couple hours of the week and see if I can, you know.
So what year for everybody to understand the timeline is, what year did you actually start MDS?
Okay, so I started MDS in 2017.
Okay.
Yeah, that's so, when he first, Fred Mastro, founder of MDS, came to one of his first at Los Angeles seminars.
Okay, all right.
I think,
But he had been already teaching in the U.S. for a while? Or?
I think he did his first seminar maybe a year before. Okay. But I missed it, you know, for you know other reasons.
Right.
And then I got to my first one, and then it hasn't stopped ever since. Now he comes to the United States twice a year.
Okay. Yeah. And there are certain gyms that teach his discipline,
yes.
right?
Yes.
Okay. And which one do you go to?
I go to Advanced Self-Defense Concepts in Upland, California.
Oh, in Upland.
Yes,
okay.
Upland, California.
All right. And
is that the IE?
Yeah, that's considered. Yes. Off the 210 somewhere?
Yeah, off the 10 as well.
Off
yeah.
the 10,
Mona Vista.
So you've been doing it for approximately 3 years now?
Yes, yes. Right. Just as a level one, nothing.
And talk to us about how the levels work. You start off just training in the gym.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have to do a specific amount of hours? Do you have to take a certain test to just even be level one? Mm-hmm. How does it go?
So Fred's really, really adamant on knowing his instructors, keeping it nice and you know close in
right.
a sense, because a lot of styles get watered down. You have so many instructors doing it so many different ways.
Right.
And he doesn't try to keep it like this, you know, like not open to other ideas.
Right.
But people will just learn and just do something completely different than what he shows.
Right. So the fundamentals have to stay there.
Yeah. You know, and fundamentals is what it's all about.
Right.
And so, you know, for us, it was, since it was so new to the United States when I first started learning it, it was just, I just kept showing up. That's all I did. I just kept showing up. I didn't miss a class. And then they're like, certification came around, and Fred would ask my instructor, Patrick Odell, who does his own, you know, style stuff now, but hey, who shows up? Who right. is dedicated? And then, you know, he'd give names, and then we'd go from there.
Right, right.
And there's, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Go ahead.
There's four levels to MDS. There's level one, which is assistant monitor. So I can just watch and see what you're doing and maybe make corrections.
Gotcha.
And there's monitor, like actually leading it.
Right.
There's assistant instructor and then instructor.
Gotcha.
Like I can lead classes on my own.
Right.
And Fred has given a certain amount of few people his okay to teach in the United States because we don't have level four instructors here.
Or right.
Aside from one named Sebastian Vandenberg, but he just recently moved here and he doesn't have a big group yet. So we still got to get some level ones. Yeah, yeah. We still have to.
Level four or level one? Level one is instructor?
No. Level four.
It's the other way around.
Yeah,
level
yeah.
four. Okay. So you don't necessarily, it's because it's fairly new. It's what, about 4 or 5 years in the U.S.?
Yes.
Right? So you don't even have level four instructors here. So, but he's given his okay to certain individuals that he trusts to actually teach.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, then who would be teaching?
Right, exactly.
Right.
Yeah,
okay.
Exactly. So that's how it goes.
And how often do you train over in Upland?
So we usually
before the COVID.
Yeah, of course, yeah, right. It's pre-COVID everything.
Yeah.
So it would normally be Monday to Saturday. That's our gym schedule,
right.
And I try to go whenever I can. I don't live in Upland, so I'll usually stay out there for an Upland for a whole week to train.
Right.
And maybe take a week off.
Gotcha.
And come back.
Gotcha.
And that's the training schedule like that is.
Okay.
There.
And what do you feel like is probably what people can learn most of out of it? You know, people have different disciplines, but the person that's like, hey, I want to get into MDS or sell it to me, for example, because there's people right now that probably maybe listening,
right?
And they're like, well, it sounds like self-defense, but isn't that what Krav Maga is or whatever, right? So what is the difference between MDS and, for example, Krav Maga? Let's just say Krav Maga because almost everybody has an idea of what they think it is.
Right.
Yeah, so what's the difference between MDS and Krav Maga?
So this is a conversation I have quite often because I can ask anybody off the streets, I'm like, have you heard of Krav Maga?
Right.
And most of them would say, yeah, the fighting style. They don't have to know where it's from.
Right.
But they know it's this kind of brutal self-defense system.
Right.
And, you know, Fred Mastro, who in MDS, has taken everything from, you know, like how Bruce Lee did with Wing Chun and Ip Man, and he's made it to what he thinks is better.
Right.
Well, not really better, but like what works, what he's seen work.
Yeah. And what that's a lot of what a lot of new, I don't want to say gurus, but like sensei, masters and everybody has done, right?
Right.
And then they've created their own fighting system.
Yeah.
Right? So Fred has done that. He's taken from, did he have an original discipline before?
Yes, Silat. Yes.
Okay,
it's
so
an Indonesian and Malaysian martial arts. Yes.
Gotcha. So he initially trained in Silat, mm-hmm. and then he started taking stuff from Wing Chun.
No, he didn't take anything from Wing Chun, but he started doing jiu-jitsu,
okay.
and he started just doing other martial arts, like Filipino martial arts, even though he's done it, because...
Oh, so you're saying he kind of used the Bruce Lee method of...
Yeah, yes, yes, gotcha, exactly, gotcha. Not exactly what he did.
Right, right, so taking different mm-hmm. pieces of what he... Which a lot of us do in our martial arts path,
mm-hmm.
even just in general, even if you never become a master or a sensei or any type of thing, if you take in martial arts long enough, you know what you're capable mm-hmm. of, right? Some of us are not as flexible as other people.
Right.
Some of us don't have a good enough ground game. Some of us are just not as fast or strong as other people. So we take the techniques that we're good at and we stick with those, right? And as we learn, we're like, mm-hmm. okay, I can do that technique too, right? So this is kind of like what he did and yeah. developed. Because he's pretty tall, right?
Yeah, he's right. He's so, like my height, around a little. Yeah.
So from when I see him on videos, mm-hmm. it looks like he has long arms.
Yes, he does.
Yeah. And
big hands too. Yeah, for knockout power. Yeah.
Tall, lanky guy, yeah. and range could be like if I were gonna go up to this guy up against him, I'd be like, well, I gotta get on the inside because mm-hmm. he looks like he's got range on me.
Right.
Right. So he figured out what he thinks are the best techniques or from whatever disciplines, and he starts combining.
Yes, okay. he says it all the time in his seminars when we have like 100 people out there for a seminar, or even online. He's like, look, my style isn't the best, like learn more, like right. take it for what it is, like, you know, if you wouldn't just use, or he describes it like, just because you know jiu-jitsu and you're a master doesn't mean you're a master of everything, and everyone could agree with
right.
that.
Yeah,
like you're not just gonna
well people forget what made Bruce Lee special is exactly what you guys said.
Mm-hmm.
He saw the style, and his argument was, it's an art, it's predictable. If you're this style, I know all your moves,
right?
He says in a real fight that's not gonna work. So he created Jeet Kune Do because he wanted to make you react,
right?
Because a lot of martial arts were, at the time, was very classical.
Fixed
things, and it was more self-defense. Let me see what you do and I'll react. And he was like, fuck that. Well, I'm gonna make you react.
Well, the reactions were fixed.
Yeah.
So like, if a guy threw a certain type of punch, there was a certain type of trap or
correct,
parry.
Correct.
And that was the discipline. If you went outside the discipline, then people would cause, you know, like,
and Bruce Lee caused a lot of anger in the martial arts community, mm-hmm. because he broke away from the art, and I think to this day, most can say he's probably the father of mixed martial arts. Yeah.
And I think, okay, like people were like, oh yeah, there's nobody that could beat Bruce Lee if it was in his prime. I'm like, and the way I see it is, Bruce Lee was, what he was creating was in his infant stage, right? He was taking what he had, what he knew at the time,
mm-hmm.
and like from Jean LaBelle and Philip FMA, and he would take, which was good, but it was in its infant stage. And nowadays people are, because there's no magic move out there that doesn't exist that someone's already come up with, right?
Right.
There's spinning back fit. There's nothing that you can do, but like, I created this move. But sometimes in jiu-jitsu, there's like, these guys are rolling around and getting into these new chokes and new stuff. And I'm like, wow, yeah, maybe, because as they flow, they feel something that they're capable of doing. And those ones, but as far as strikes, I think, in my opinion, there's no strike that hasn't been done by somebody in some art at some point.
No.
You know what I mean? In combat, I guess, you know?
Yeah,
so.
For sure.
But so, like in jiu-jitsu, like I said, I do believe that they're coming up with new stuff, because I've seen they do it rolling, but maybe some guy in Russia has already done that or something, you know, like something crazy already.
But it's the human body, right?
Yeah,
if you're more flexible,
right?
Like BJ Penn, I see him do stuff like, I'm like, how the... But because he's flexible.
Right.
Like, no other person is going to be able to pull that off.
Right.
So
right.
I think, like you said on a couple of podcasts ago, it's your natural abilities too.
Right. Well, of course, yeah.
This is one thing that I've had a conversation with to a lot of people about. It's for like stand-up self-defense, we don't want like a million different techniques to do something, you know?
Yeah, that's like Bruce Lee's method. I don't want like 100 different
jabs,
moves.
This is what's confusing to people that don't know about jiu-jitsu. There is a million different ways to do something.
Yeah.
Right.
So it is intimidating, but it's one of the most effective styles.
Right.
So it's one of those things where like when people like talk bad about stand-up, like how do I need to do these so many techniques to get to this one point? Well, it's the same with on the ground game. Sometimes you do need more than one option, because what if you don't know what another person knows, and you don't know if they can do the same thing
correct.
To you?
Right.
And then you need to know something else aside from this one all thing. Mm-hmm. I agree. Like, keep it, you know.
I felt like when I was doing jiu-jitsu, I want to learn certain moves, right? Because mm-hmm. I want to learn it. But then as you grow into it, it's more like, let me trick this guy. I want him to make, I want to make you think I'm going to do this so I can trap you so I can do the move that I want to do. And it was more mental after that.
Mm-hmm. But see, that's a problem is when you're fighting, if you get stuck on, I want to do this move.
Yeah.
You might miss another move that you're able.
That's why I'm here doing a podcast, man. I didn't get to become
MMA. Because like, let's say you learn the rear naked, right?
Yeah.
And then you want to just keep trying to get into that rear naked. Yeah. You want to do a rear naked. You're missing probably about 10, 20 moves that you could have done.
Correct.
Because you're focusing on that guy. I want to get this guy.
But that's why I'm agreeing with Roy. Like he put a good point, because the more you do it, the more, because nobody knows what the next person is going to do. So it is kind of a mind game, but the more he gets exposed to, the more different fighters he gets exposed to, he's gonna be like, I seen this move before.
Right. You're gonna feel
something.
I'm gonna get him, right?
Yeah, you're gonna feel something coming.
Yeah. So you're doing MDS, mm-hmm. and you've done it for about 3 years now. What does it take for day one? What's the first day for someone that's never done martial arts? Like you said, the mm-hmm. mother of two children, right?
Mm-hmm.
She walks into the gym, she's like, I want to learn MDS. Mm-hmm. What does the very first day look like for her? So, she doesn't even know how to stand properly.
Right.
Anything, just walks in.
So we keep it pretty honest. We talk about five targets of attack. And the five targets are things, I'll explain it to you right now after I explain the five targets. So the first target is an ear. So we try to break it down, like, you don't have to be big and strong to be able to defend yourself.
Right.
And a lot of people are intimidated, and that's why they don't go to martial arts gyms or self-defense, because they think they're gonna walk into these professionals and don't right. understand that there are people that every day, not just the house mom or house dad or whatever, the kid. So we talk about five targets, which are the ears, the eyes, the nose, the throat, you know, solar plexus, the groin. Are we talking about these targets? And what are these targets that you can't do? Or what are so apparent about these targets? You can't work them out in the gym. So no matter how small you are, if a girl pokes you in the eyes, or a smaller person hits you in the eyes or claps you in the ear, you're gonna have a reaction, unless right. you're like crazy off the board, and then we have a whole different type of conversation to have.
Right, right, right.
So like, we talk about that, like, hey, you know, it's easy. We wanna make it easy, like, where you don't have to come in, you know, for 5 days a week, 4 hours a day to get some solid training.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And you know, a lot of people gravitate, because that's what self-defense is. It's a lot of people can't differentiate self-defense to MMA, even though MMA is self-defense, because you do know how to fight and protect yourself.
Right.
But it's not the woman, the mother walking to her car with their kids after she got
it. Well, what you're
explaining
is the average Joe.
Yes, exactly. It is, in a sense. You know?
Like, because the average Joe is going to know certain things, right?
Yeah, you can't take anything away from them. But
MMA, you're fighting a trained combat that knows.
You're fighting someone in your weight class.
Yeah. It's a sport. Not taking
train
anything
as hard
away.
As you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
At a camp, not taking anything away from saying, like, it's not a self-defense
yeah,
thing.
Like,
but
okay,
it is.
If you go up against a pro MMA fighter in the street, you're still going to fucking get fucked up.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's not like some martial art that doesn't apply in the street. Of course it applies mm-hmm. in the street. How many videos have we seen guys doing MMA, doing leg kicks, doing takedowns? There's one in Pasadena where a cholo
gets dropped.
Yeah, he does a couple leg kicks, takes a double leg, brings him in, takes him down.
Wait,
right?
The cholo did that?
No. Oh. The cholo gets,
I was like, damn.
And his head hits the freaking ground, he's done. Yeah. Right? So that's all considered MMA. You got a little bit of Muay Thai, you got a little bit of wrestling, right? So of course it's going to apply in the streets. But there's, you know, and then we go into the other arguments where, like, you don't want to get taken down on the ground, on the in the sidewalk, in the cement, in the street, and stuff like that. And that's all up to variables that might happen, you know? Because if that's your only option, mm-hmm. right, then that's your only option. If this guy's bigger than you, right, stronger than you, and you can't even get in on him, if that's the only thing that you can do is get a takedown or go to the ground, then that's your whatever you need to do to survive, right?
The problem with street fighting is this. There is no rules, and they always got a homie.
So
or
it shouldn't
two.
Be street.
Well, that's one of the reasons.
You know what I'm talking about.
It shouldn't be street fighting.
You know
that's
what I'm talking
whole
about.
Point.
Well,
that
that's one of the reasons why people say don't get. That's one of the reasons why you don't want to get taken to the ground, because you don't know who's going to jump in and start kicking you and stuff like that. And that's happened to me before.
That happened to me before, too. It's like, come on, 1-on-1. But it was never 1-on-1. Before you even get to punch, the homie hits you from behind.
Right.
And half of your face goes black.
Right.
And you can't think left to right.
That's where we have to separate the MMA style of fighting from the, you know, street self-defense thing, because it's not, I'm going to punch you, you're going to punch me. I might get blindsided or a boxer's chance and stuff like that. So, you know, we train where people are being not compliant, but just kind of standing face to face like we're about to fight. Like, you know, people, like some dumbasses get in front of you like, what's that for me? Like, and you're like, if square you're experienced, you're like, you just did something perfect for me. Like, I'm exactly. just going to mess you up. So you still have to do preemptive strikes.
I try not to get to that point. No, no one should. But yeah. if I get to the point where he's really confronting me,
yeah.
I'm going to swing.
Of course.
I'm going to be the cool guy and you know, bam. Because I grew up in the hood. It's like, I'm the little guy. I got to get one out.
You don't have to wait
and
for
if
someone
I don't
to
knock,
punch you.
If I don't knock him out, then I start running, dude.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. See, that's the... That's
you're the little guy. You got to do what little guys do.
That's what people get... They misunderstand that you have to wait till someone punches you for you to punch back. As long as you feel threatened,
yeah, you got to do it.
You okay?
Whatever your heart tells you, you got to do it.
And as long as you, not whatever your heart tells you, you could be drunk or whatever at the time.
I'm gonna
like, fucking fuck this dude up. He didn't even do anything, right?
No, I'm not gonna do that. I'm just saying.
But if you can articulate why you punched first, mm-hmm. and be like, this guy was already bigger than taller than
yeah.
me. He was already intimidating me.
Correct.
Right. Then
told
them
to stop too.
Because you know this, and you took martial arts. If that dude grabs you, your chance of survival goes down because he's much bigger and stronger.
Oh, yeah.
So why not even, don't even get there. Don't even get there. Don't even get to the ground. Like, you can.
So the keys to that is be able to articulate it and get a good lawyer. Always. No, seriously.
A lawyer?
No. Yeah, of course, dude. Because no one's going to have your best interest when you, because you're still going to have to go to court.
Correct.
Right? So no one's going to have your best interest. You know, a public defender, maybe, but do you want to leave it to the justice
correct,
system,
correct.
Right? So get
correct.
A good lawyer. Other than that, you got anything you want to talk about? Anything else? You know, bring up anything?
You guys are talking about great things right now. I just, about the whole attacking first thing.
Right.
I think it's one thing that I really took back from the military is people are like, I don't think I could do that to somebody. Or like, oh, I would never be able to hurt someone like
yeah.
that. And a lot of people like fail to realize like it does come down to that barbaric attitude.
Yeah.
And
right.
it's either you or
fight
me.
Fight or flight, right?
Yeah, it's either fight or flight.
Yeah,
it's either you or me.
Yeah.
Like, and you have to understand that if you're going to take these classes, it's not just, I feel cool, I know how to do this disarm or technique. It's
right.
you're literally training this to keep you safe. And
so let me piggyback out what you said. Yeah. And this is when I was training to be a lifeguard. I remember first day of class, the instructor was like, mm-hmm. if you're afraid to see people die, you need to walk out because it's going to happen. And I sat there and I thought about like, fuck, dude.
Did you leave?
I'm here thinking like,
yeah,
I want to save
you.
People.
He's like,
no, I didn't leave.
He's like, all right, I'm going to head out.
I didn't leave. No, but I came from a swim team doing all, you know, butterfly, all these strokes. And then I'm here like, yeah, I want to be a lifeguard. And then the first day of class, the first sentence that came out of his mouth was that. I'm like, I never even thought about
holy
that.
Shit,
that's
people
pretty,
can die?
That's pretty hard.
Yeah.
Like, oh,
like,
whoa.
Like,
yeah, that's a pretty hard line.
You're not
going right
to be
there.
Able to say, but he wasn't bullshitting.
Yeah,
he laid it down the line, and if you stayed in, you knew what you were getting yourself into.
Right.
Because being a lifeguard.
Well, some people are not good with blood.
No.
Some people are not good with
it's not
people
for you.
Dying, dude. They freak out. They don't know what to
do. Yeah.
Some, I just watched a video the other day where this lady... She gives and the cop does it right in front of his camera in the hood, or the front car cam, and he starts saving this baby. He's doing CPR on the baby,
mm-hmm.
as you should with the two fingers and right here, yeah. and then the back blows, and the mom is just like just in circles,
scared,
dude.
Scared.
Wigging.
Yeah, just wigging out in circles, and I'm like, dude, that's just. Identifies, but this what comes to, that's what we talked about, knowledge comes with that, right? Mm-hmm. So no one ever, the cop could have been very panicked too, because if he didn't know how to do CPR, what could have he had done? He would have just gone on the radio, right. and said, hey, I need someone, and he would have probably been in, he's not going to show it, or
right.
you know,
in freak mode,
but he's going to be in freak mode inside because he doesn't know how to save this baby, mm-hmm. and this baby's life is on his hands.
Yeah.
But this is what we talk about, knowledge overcomes fear.
Correct.
Right? Because if you know something, she's obviously scared because she doesn't know how to do CPR. She's never done it. Then you're going to panic. But the cop was like, okay, I know how to do CPR. Let me try this.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And so he's like, okay, I know this. So if you know this, the knowledge overcomes fear. Right?
For sure.
We're all scared of certain things. But then you know, you're like, oh man, I'm scared of climbing that mountain.
Look, right? When the first time we went to Angeles Crest, this place called Monkey Canyon. And I remember, this one person jumps and he didn't come up because his head hit the rock in the bottom.
Right.
The dude came out blue.
Yeah.
And I have CPR training.
Right.
I know lifeguarding.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But I never seen a dude blue where I had to put my what I know.
Right.
And everyone's panicking and I'm like, take a deep breath, do what you know. And
exactly.
I'm here, like, something happened where I took me out of the equation and I just focused on the task. Like, everything went silent. Man. I was just as scared. I never seen someone blue. I don't know if he was breathing. And I'm like, find a pose, just do the procedure, right?
Right.
Get this guy back.
Right.
Pink.
Start getting your compressions.
You always
and
go back to your training and your
second
nature.
Yeah, dude. And I think to that day, had I not been there, this dude's dead.
Yeah, exactly. Or had you not had the training, the knowledge, you would have been
trying to get on the phone.
Yeah, not just like, this guy's blue, like oh shit. Like,
like this guy's fucking blue, like how they describe
it. Blue?
Yeah, you, I mean, when you train, they tell you.
Yeah.
They come out this color, and you're like, well, how blue, right?
Yeah.
And then to the moment you see it, you're like,
oh,
that motherfucker's blue.
Yeah, because all that blue. Blood, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's crazy, man. It's freaking scary, man.
Yeah. So what ended up happening? Save the dude? Or you kept doing him till EMT arrived?
I think he was in shock and he swallowed some water. I didn't really have to do much. I just had to pump some, you know, just going through procedures, and he started coughing it up.
Right.
He looked at me like I was Jesus.
Well, there you go, bro.
Yeah, man.
You did something. You might probably
saved his life. Check it out. After that moment, I was shaking.
Right.
I didn't know where I was. Well,
that's the nerves, dude.
Yeah, I was shaking.
Wait till the nerves come out.
I was like, I just need to sit down. I don't know what the fuck just happened. Like, where the fuck
hero,
are we?
No
No. Like, just shaking. Like,
yeah. Well, that's the nerves. And then you just got to wait for them to wear off, and then you're back.
Yeah, dude. It's fucking scary, dude. Scary.
Yeah. That's cool. So, you got anything else you want to say?
Oh, man. Just, if you guys are listening, anyone who's listening, just follow my Instagram. It's Roy_ASD Concepts, you know, at Instagram. And follow some of my stuff. You know, I like to post a lot about my life and tell people out. You know, I know a lot of people are afraid of talking about their problems and they can't relate to anybody, and
or they fear that people aren't gonna accept them for who they are, right?
And I'm there, you know. I have a following that has a lot of people that just want to talk to me about stuff, and if I can do it for you, I'm 100% there. Even if you're a stranger, family member, all the above, if you have something you need to talk about, you let me know.
You want to give a shout out to your gym, you guys call them gyms as well?
Yep, Studios is my gym. Yeah, it's in Upland, California, and it's Advanced Self-Defense Concepts. It's ran under Chief Instructor Jared Arbuckle, Mastro Defense System, Fred Mastro, you know, one of my best friends, Patrick Oldall, and Grandmaster Felix Royales.
Oh, Royales?
Yeah,
Royales, I know Royales, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a good guy.
Yep, that's it.
Well, right. Vince, man, what a great guest you have, Roy. It's
Thank you. Honor and pleasure meeting you.
And Vince, another good show under your belt, brother.
Yeah, I appreciate it. You guys.
So, before I sign off, I just want to make sure, if you guys haven't already, please subscribe. We are in episode 2 now. No, season 2, episode 2. Season 1's all done. We work hard. We want to have guests and share their insight and knowledge and let everyone know that, hey, we're all in this together.
We're on YouTube.
And we are the same. We don't have no special powers.
YouTube, Spotify.
YouTube, Spotify, Anchor, and Apple Podcasts.
Gotcha. So there you go.
And we are signing out.
All right, guys. Have a good one.
Thank you.
Peace.